All right, Shalom, Brother Yashawama. I want to start off by giving all praise to Yahweh Shemiel Shai, double honors to the elders and apostles at GMS, and blessings to the elect. Today, basically, I wanted to present you brothers with a documentary that I found to be edifying. And before I did that, I wanted to read a few scriptures so that it all makes sense with the image of the beast and how America has taken on the customs of ancient Rome and is the last leg of this whole beast system, okay? So we'll start here. See, one of the things here that we have as men of the Lord, we have the secrets of why. You know, a lot of people are rising up talking crap and talking nonsense about the Bible, you know, but all they talk about is how great, you know, they were in this or this and this and that. But our doctrine explains why. Got the Egyptologists. We were great. We were such great people. Okay. Why are we at the bottom? Okay. Why is this white man able to do what he is doing on the planet Earth? Why is this weakling? Why was he able to come and just take us down, put us on ships, and put us in slavery? Okay. Why is America thriving the way that it's thriving? Why are things the way they are? And the scriptures have the answer. You niggas do not have the answer, okay? All right, so let's start here with Revelation 13 and 11. It says, and I beheld another beast coming up out of the earth. And this is representative of man. It's symbolic of a nation, okay, given power and rulership on the planet Earth, okay? All right? And it calls him a beast. And he had two horns like a lamb. All right. This is representative of how America has the whole world believing that they have two systems that are against each other. And that system is for the people. When in actuality, that system is to further enslave you and put you in sleep. And they're for each other. All right. They're all together. All right. They're all puppets. Okay. It's a false sense of freedom, a false sense of hope in which you have niggas in the black consciousness community still trying to take hold unto this system. All right? And it says, and he spake as a dragon. All right? So why? It says two horns like a lamb. All right? Like the Democrats, the Republicans back in the Roman Empire. You had the plebeians and the patricians. All right? But it's a very corrupt system. All right? At the end of the day, it's very corrupt and it's not for you, right? And he spake as a dragon, okay? Now, he has horns like a lamb, okay? Which represents, a lamb represents a meek and humble thing, okay? So they try to act like they're meek and humble and for you, but they speak as a dragon, all right? Everything that they say burns you, okay? Everything that they're doing is burning you. Right? Verse 12 says, and he exercises all the power of the first beast before him. Okay? And who's the first beast before him? The Roman Empire. The ancient Roman Empire. Okay? And he calls it the earth and them which that dwell therein to worship the first beast. Alright? And America is doing that through its customs. Okay? You are worshiping the ancient Roman Empire way of life, which is of Satan. When you got guys who say they agree with homosexuality, you're worshiping the beast, okay? When you have taken hold to the system, all right, and believe through it is your only way to be happy, you have taken hold to this system, okay? Which it says, and he exercises all the power of the first beast before him and calls it the earth and them which dwell therein to worship the first beast whose deadly wound was healed. Now, whose deadly wound was healed? When you read up in the third verse, it says, and I saw one of his heads as it were wounded to death. All right. And what is this prophecy about? This is a prophecy of when the ancient Roman Empire fell. Okay. Through a man named Severus Septimius. All right. He led an army and they were able to take the so-called white man down. And for about 1,000 years, they call it the Dark Ages. All right. So-called black people of color, all right, were in rulership, living as kings, all right, and we had queens on the planet Earth, all right. Now, were they the most righteous people at the time? No, the law, statutes, and commandments wasn't put in them, but that's a part of history. They call it the Dark Ages, the Byzantine Empire, which means backwards, okay? So this is, he was wounded to death, all right? And it says, and his deadly wound was healed, all right? And what, how was it healed? Through the Renaissance period, when the so-called white man was able to come back into power, all right? And what did he do when he came back into power? He took down our dark images and started painting white images, okay? Painted over the dark images, started hiding the history that we were ruling, all right? And then eventually, he put us in slavery, okay? And all of this is in the Bible, okay? As it were, we're wounded to death, and his deadly wound was healed. That's the Renaissance period, and all the world wondered after the beast, and all of the world is wondering after the beast, okay? All of the empires since then, all right, that have raised on the planet Earth, from the French, the Spanish, the British, okay, on down to America, have carried the customs of the ancient Roman Empire, all right, with its sun worship, all right, its way of living, which you're going to see in the documentary, and the whole world is wondering after that, man. All right, verse 4, it says, and they worshiped the dragon, which gave power unto the beast, and they worshiped the beast, saying, who is like unto the beast, who was able to make war with him? And that's the mind frame of you dumb Americans. Even you black consciousness niggas believe this. You are in this mind frame. Who is like unto America? Who can make war with America? All right? So that's why you submit to America. All right? Your doctrine has no promise of what is going to happen to America, or what is our way out of this hellhole we in. All right? Verse 5 says, and there was given unto him a mouth speaking great things and blasphemies. All right? And he is speaking great things and blasphemies, man. All right? He's basically lying on the scriptures, lying on the men of the Lord, saying he's the Jew. He's speaking great things. All right? Women are over men. All of these things are being... let's jump to verse 6. It says, and he opened his mouth in blasphemy against the Most High, all right, to blaspheme his name and his tabernacle in them that dwell in heaven. So that going basically into what I was saying, going into, man. All right? So let's jump back down here so we can get to the documentary. Verse 12, and it says, he exercises all the power of the first beast before him and causes the earth and them that dwell therein to worship the first beast whose deadly wound was healed. So now you have an understanding. The ancient Roman Empire is being worshipped, okay, through this new beast who has a horns like a lamb but speaks as a dragon, which is America. And America is exercising all of the policies and the way of living of the ancient Roman Empire. Homosexuality, revelry, shopping malls, everything, which you'll see in the documentary. I don't want to ruin it. And it says, and he doeth great wonders. America does do great wonders, okay? So that he maketh fire come down from heaven on earth in the sight of men. That's his nuclear bombs, okay? Verse 14 is the point. And he deceiveth them that dwell on the earth by the means of those miracles which he had power to do in the sight of the beast, saying to them that dwell on the earth, okay, that they should make an image, okay? Now this image, all right, is talking about the way of life and everything you see before you, man. All right? To the beast, all right? So the America is forcing on the world the image of the ancient Roman Empire, man. All right? And if you're not down with it, you're basically outcasted, man. Okay? All right? So let's read it again. And he had power to give life unto the image of the beast. And he's given life unto the image of the beast. And you can look around and see that, man. That the image of the beast should both speak and cause as many as would not worship the beast, worship the image of the beast, should be killed. Okay? So there you go. All right? And through this system, I just want to add this, through this system that we're talking about here, all right, that is doing these great miracles and have people sleep and drunk and going around the world forcing its way, all right, up on the world, all right? Like Saddam Hussein, for instance, he was about to take the dollar, which he was already starting to do. He took the dollar. He did away with the dollar. He was going to start a whole new thing, basically. He did away with the dollar. So what did America do? They created propaganda and they killed him. Okay? That's just a small sanction of the image of the beast, his money system. All right? In the ancient Roman Empire, they had the denarius. In America, they have the dollar. Okay? And both would eventually fall. So, and through this system, it says, and he calls it all, both small, great, rich and poor, free and bond, to receive a mark in their right hand or in their foreheads, that no man might buy or sell, save that he have the mark or the name of the beast or the number of his name. Okay, so this system, America, would, through this American system, the mark of the beast would be pushed upon a whole planet Earth. All right, as well as this Roman satanic way of life. Okay. So, with that, here's the documentary, and I hope you brothers are edified. Shalom.
Rome, the Eternal City. It was founded over 2,700 years ago by twin brothers Romulus and Remus. For centuries, the people and emperors of Rome ruled the known world. Through war and conquest, they dominated the entire Mediterranean and controlled a territory which spanned three continents. It was home to legendary figures like Julius Caesar and Augustus, but also to crazed emperors Nero and Caligula. Rome's history is a violent one. It was a civilization founded on bloodshed and lust, and would eventually destroy itself in the same manner. Is that all Rome had to offer? Typical perceptions of Rome include constant gladiator games, wine-fueled orgies, and prosperity among all. These are all dramatized visions of a glorious culture that was far more similar to our own than it was different. Their influence and contributions can be felt even today. By examining the history and culture of ancient Rome, we're able to see that not all of Rome died in its collapse. Every day, we're surrounded by common symbols which owe their meaning and lasting appeal to the Romans. For instance, the Great Seal of the United States shows an eagle clutching arrows in one leg and an olive branch in the other. Imagery such as this is usually interpreted as uniquely American. The eagle, however, was not always a symbol for American nationalism. In Roman mythology, the eagle was the companion of the chief god Jupiter, and it was used widely throughout Rome, adorning statues and temples. Its religious associations would have been widely known throughout the Roman world. It was also used by the military, which carried standards with the bird of Jupiter mounted on top. In recent history, others have used the eagle to create a memorable link with the ancient past. Napoleon Bonaparte's Grand Army used it to decorate their standards, banners, and uniforms. It was also incorporated into the emblem of the consulate after Napoleon declared himself first consul, a title also derived from ancient Rome. During World War II, the Nazis held party rallies and demonstrations while carrying Roman standards which were topped with the eagle. At the same time, fascist dictator Benito Mussolini, who envisioned Italy becoming a new Rome, also used ancient Roman symbols, including the fasces. It was a tool carried by Roman civil servants known as lictors in order to preserve the peace or hand out punishment. Even the word fascism is derived from the ancient Roman tool. It also appears in numerous forms throughout the United States, representing strength or justice. The olive branch was also used in everyday life by the Romans. Olives were a precious commodity in the ancient world, despite the amount of labor required to produce them. Extending an olive branch to an enemy, therefore, became known as a symbol offering peace, as they could only be grown during peacetime. The olive branch appears on the official seal of the president, which has been in use since 1880, and on the United Nations flag. Thank you. In the mid-first century BC, Julius Caesar replaced the old Roman calendar, which had 355 days, with a new one, reorganized with 365 days, with one leap year every 4 years. The renovated Julian calendar is essentially identical to the calendar system used today. Originally, the older style calendar put the beginning of the new year in March, at the start of spring. Julius Caesar had the new year coincide with the 1st of January. Most of the names for the months are derived from the original Roman names as well. January, from Janus, god of doorways and beginnings. February is derived from the Roman festival of Februa. March is the month of Mars, the god of war. April comes from the Roman month Aprilis. May, for the Roman Maya, goddess of spring. June is named after the queen of the gods, Juno. July gets its name from Julius Caesar, who rededicated the month after himself. August was renamed in the same fashion after Augustus, first emperor of Rome. And September, October, November, and December simply mean the 7th, 8th, 9th, and 10th month. Certain religious festivals from ancient Rome were replaced with Christian holidays as paganism declined under alternate names but with similar meaning. A Roman festival known as Lupercalia celebrated fertility and health. It was held February 15th and is the modern equivalent of St. Valentine's Day. Often used as a symbol for the modern holiday is the chubby winged child known as Cupid, which was the Roman god of erotic love. In December, Romans would honor the god Saturn during the week-long celebration of Saturnalia. This was held at the end of the month and is believed to be the basis for celebrating Christmas during this time. One of Rome's often forgotten but inescapable contributions is their language. Although it is not spoken directly, the majority of words in the English language, at least 60% and probably higher, are derived from Latin. Many common names such as Marcus or Julia are Latin words. Even the name America is taken from a Latinized version of Amerigo, the person it was named for. Other languages spoken around the world also developed from Latin. They are known collectively as the Romance languages. The main ones include Spanish, Portuguese, French, and Italian. Including English-speaking countries, it's estimated that over 1 billion people today speak a language which traces its roots to Latin. Another important contribution from ancient Rome in use today is their alphabet. Numerous writing systems around the world, English included, base their alphabet on the Latin characters. With the exception of J, U, and W, the capital letters of the English alphabet are identical. Besides the basis for languages, Latin is also used in the Linnaeus taxonomy system, developed by Carl Linnaeus in the 18th century to classify and arrange organisms. Thanks to Linnaeus and Latin, humans are scientifically classified as Homo sapiens. Many legal terms in use today, such as habeas corpus, in absentia, stare decisis, and others are taken directly from Latin. At the heart of Rome was its government. During the Republic era, a code of laws known as the 12 Tables were created, which protected the rights of all citizens. Roman law would eventually spread and become the foundation for numerous law systems throughout the world. Because of the 6th century Emperor Justinian, who collected all works of law and assembled them in a single doctrine, Roman law was preserved until modern day. In one form or another, it was the basis for most of the European law systems until the end of the 18th century. And even the English common law, which helped influence the U.S. Constitution, borrowed from the ancient laws of Rome. Even in America, founding fathers like Thomas Jefferson and John Adams hung on every word of Roman writers like Sallust, Tacitus, and Cicero, considering every character they wrote worth studying. George Washington was considered the Cincinnatus of America for his reluctance to hold power and his patriotism for his country. Because of this, many statues were created with Washington dressed in Roman-style clothing. Many of the buildings of ancient Rome have been lost to time, but were left with a small piece of their majesty. One of the most influential pieces we have is the Pantheon, a temple which was dedicated to all the gods. Its design, which is quite different than other temples in the Roman world, due to its square column front and large dome interior, has been replicated in almost every state capitol building in America, including the Capitol in Wisconsin. The Emperor Trajan was centuries ahead of his time when he built what is considered the first multi-story shopping mall, and it was equipped with the ancient equivalent of all the stores we might find in a modern mall. Sports fans as well owe some debt to the Romans for their architectural endeavors. Modern stadiums, which itself is a Latin word, are modeled after amphitheaters, a must in any great Roman town. The most famous of them is undoubtedly the Colosseum. Romans also loved going to the races at the Circus Maximus, a large oval track used for chariot racing. The Romans, like audiences today, enjoyed a good spectacle, often betting on their favorite gladiator or charioteer. There were also inventions like the hypocaust system, which circulated warm air through chambers beneath flooring. It was especially useful in bathhouses where heated floors were a necessity. This subfloor heating is similar to a system in homes today, centuries after it was first conceived. The empire eventually came to an end, destroyed by barbarians. Ancient Rome exists now only in its legacy. As the saying goes, not only do all roads lead to Rome, but most of our culture does as well. The people of Rome were very similar to the people of the world today. They worked the land, loved to be entertained, and were extremely resourceful and creative. The people in the cities created a melting pot of ethnicities, each contributing a bit of their heritage to the Roman way of life. One could argue that without Rome, our world today could never exist. In the words of Professor Charles Hershey, Rome is modern, progressive, a present force among the cities of the world, even as she is the treasure house of the ages. He continues, ancient Rome has left to her successors much more than her forums, her temples and arches, and her arenas. She has bequeathed her civilization, including her laws, her customs, her literature, and her philosophy. They are a part of our civilization today.